Hey church, welcome to Church Online. We're so glad that you are here and joining us. Stay tuned for more information coming on our Christmas Eve services. We'll have that very soon. But we do have something happening on December 20th. We're going to do a Zoom service and it's called Songs of Hope. So make sure to stay tuned for the Zoom link on that and more information. Church, thank you for being generous with the resources and finances that God has given you. If you'd like to give, check out the link in the description. And also make sure to check out this week's worship music playlist. If you're not in a Discovery community yet, make sure to reach out to Melissa. You can email her at mpearson@dcboise.org. We hope you enjoy this special message from Pastor Matt.
Good morning, Discovery Church. And anybody else who is tuning in or watching this later, thankful to have another opportunity to share with you today. I wanna welcome you to the final days of 2020. I was thinking back earlier this week about how much was happening last fall and how many things I heard about 2020 and 2020 vision and all these different kinds of ideas of what this year was going to be like. And how unexpected it turned out to be, and how challenging and difficult and stressful and just very different this year has been, and yet how much God has been at work in the midst of it. So anyway, I know lots of highs and lows. It's been very interesting. And as we enter into this season, it is a season of hope as we look toward the birth of Jesus and remember what that meant and what that means for us as followers of Jesus, that this is a season of expectancy and of hope and looking forward to not only the fact that Jesus came, but that he's coming again. And so I pray that this would be the kind of season that we just remember that we serve a loving God, that we serve a God who sees us where we are, who knows our hearts, and is always inviting us deeper and deeper with him, and to continue to be partnering with him to do the work that Jesus initiated. When he came and began his ministry, he began by saying, "Repent and believe, the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And it is still at hand today, moving in and through us and in the church." So he is the God of light and of love. And this is a season where we get to remember that we are salt and light as people. So on that note, we have something kind of fun that we are excited about. We are going to have the first annual Discovery Church Christmas Lights Contest. We were just thinking and praying, coming up with some ideas of things that we could do to have some fun together and just share the light and the love and the hope that we have in Jesus. And so this was one of those fun ideas. Maybe it will be annual, who knows? But we wanna encourage you, challenge you. I encourage you right now to comment in the comments if you are in and interested in just joining a fun contest. I mean, what's more fun than a little healthy and fun competition? So comment below if you are interested and willing to participate. And here's what we're gonna do. We're gonna choose a couple of nights where those of you have said we're in, you're gonna decorate your homes if you haven't already with lights and whatever kinds of fun things. And we will send out a map with each of the homes and families that are participating so we can all go out, drive around, see each other's houses, give each other a wave, encourage each other, maybe vote for our favorites and just have some fun. Who knows, maybe we'll have some hot cider and hot chocolate stations set up to just be able to enjoy, get out and do some fun things together. And I also know some of you who may be either of an age or a physical capacity where you probably shouldn't be climbing on a ladder. And I know others of you who live in apartments in different places where maybe you can't put up lights. Maybe if you're interested in participating, but you're not able to get up on a ladder, decorate your house, maybe we can pair some of you up to be able to do some of that together. So if you're interested in that and say, "I wanna do it, but I really can't, I need some help," comment and share those kinds of things too. Let's have some fun. These are just great ways to do that. Speaking of which, we've been hearing a number of you sharing different kinds of things you're going to do and that you want to do this season to get out and to enjoy and have fun and share this hope that we have and just be a blessing and a light. And so some of you are doing things like meeting up to go caroling. That is fantastic. Let's invite and share those kinds of things on our social media. You can comment on the graphics that we'll put out for the Christmas Lights contest if you want to participate. But also, if you're going out caroling, invite some other people to do that. I know some Discovery communities are meeting up to go do that. With new restrictions that are in place, not much that's new. Just make sure you're out there being safe and having fun with distance and masks when necessary. But also, let's just get out and just bring and share the joy that we have because of who God is. So let's do that. And if there's other things that you're doing, that you're praying about, that you know are happening in the community, let's share and talk about those things so that we can engage in all kinds of different ways that God would lead us to just elevate the level of hope and peace in a season where there is tension, there is anxiety and nervousness as we head into what some are saying is gonna be a long, hard, and challenging winter. But we have the presence, we have the peace and the joy that carries through our challenges and our circumstances. God has been building endurance in us, church. And so let's continue to walk in that together so that others who are looking for that, that are looking for hope and purpose and looking for safe places, that they can see that in us. So let's take a minute. And let's just pray together that God would prepare our hearts. Father, we thank you for the opportunity to come together, Lord, to hear more than anything what you are saying to us as your church right now. We trust you. Would you open our minds and hearts, open our ears and our eyes, Lord? Would you give us a hunger and a thirst for your word and for hearing your voice? Would you give us hearts that are responsive to you? And we just thank you, Jesus, for your great love. And we continually want to be doing what you did, Jesus, and becoming more and more like you in our love and grace and the way that we pursue others who are far from you. So we thank you for it, Jesus, in your name. Amen. Amen. Well, we have been studying and practicing our faith together. We've been talking about, we've begun talking about two dimensions of Jesus's relational life, his upward relationship with the Father and his inward relationship with his disciples and those he was in close relationship with. And we're going to begin now to talk about the outward dimension of his faith, outward toward the world and those who were far from him. And last week, we got to hear from Cody and Allie and little Sophia. Last week was the first Sunday of Advent. And so we heard a little bit of a life story from Cody and Allie about the hope that they have in this season and how God has been with them through some challenges. And today we're gonna hear a little bit more. Today is the second Sunday, the second week of Advent. And we're gonna hear a little bit more about peace from Monty and Ann Ralston. So I'd encourage you, hop up. If you have a candle nearby, go grab one. Let's light those again together. And I'm gonna light my light as we hear a little more of this story.
Well, this is the second Sunday of Advent, and we light the peace candle. Last week it was hope, and hopefully we've all looked forward to this Sunday when we can come to the peace candle. So as we light this, we do it remembering that Jesus came as the Prince of Peace. And so in him was peace personified. When we think about peace, I'm thinking that probably one of the things that has been the hardest for us recently, not just for us, but for others as well, and that is finding peace in the midst of a pandemic, in the midst of all kinds of opinions, and one day it's this, what the experts, and one day it's that, and you don't know. There is that place that we need to come to of peace. And realizing, I guess, that not everybody has all the answers to these things. But how we react is the thing that Ann and I have really talked about. And we want to be in that place of peace and being obedient to what God says about it. And Jesus said in John 14, he says, "Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Do not let your heart be troubled, nor let it be fearful. And I like that because it tells us not to be fearful, and there's a lot of fear in the midst of pandemic. So we elected to be careful, but not be fearful. And it has sustained us during this time in relationships. We've not withdrawn completely from relationships or anything, but it has really sustained us.
And the wonderful thing is we know who gives us our peace, and it's certainly not what we hear from others or what we hear on television. It has to do with the Prince of Peace. In fact, when we first heard about the pandemic back in March, we were like, oh dear, we're going to have to really care for some of our older friends. And then once they started talking about who was vulnerable, we realized, oh dear, I think they're counting us in.
That's us.
So we had to make some decisions, mm-hmm. just like all of you did, but we were so thankful that we had the tools that the Prince of Peace had given us, and that's his word, prayer, and you all. I know some of you are living alone, and no matter whether we're together with other people or alone, we really need to run things by those that we trust. When we don't feel peaceful. And Monty said earlier that it doesn't mean that you don't have emotions, that you can't feel fearful. It's what we do with that fear that causes the internal change. In fact, when Monty and I have been talking all day about this, and I thought, you know, sometimes I just got through reading Acts, and sometimes we long for those miracles, you know, that those notable miracles that we can see. But you know, and I know that when we have been fearful, or when we have been confused, or when we have circumstances in our lives that are not in our control, that we really have to trust that if we call on Him, that He will answer. And when that peace comes, isn't that a miracle? Because you can't generate that yourself. That's why we need Him so desperately. One of my favorite scriptures that I've been meditating on during this time is Philippians 4:6. Don't worry about anything. Well, that's easier said than done, right? But instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank Him for what He has done. Then you will experience God's peace, which exceeds anything we can understand. His peace will guard our hearts and minds as we live in Christ Jesus. And really, that's what all of this is about. It's learning to appreciate the things that we're missing, mm-hmm. the people, you all, that we're desperately missing, and just finding that miracle of peace, because that's what He came to give us. We're never alone. The Holy Spirit's always with us.
So as we look forward to anticipating and celebrating the birth of the Prince of Peace, the New Living Translation says the same verse that I shared at the beginning in a different way. I'm leaving you with a gift, Jesus says, peace of mind and heart. And the peace I give is a gift the world cannot give. So don't be troubled or afraid. So I guess I would go back and take the words of Joshua. Let's all be bold and courageous, live in that place of peace, and trust Him for all we need.
So good. Such a great heart and reminder of the peace. I love that. Monty and Ann specifically, because we had a little bit of this conversation with them saying, oh, we have to be really concerned about the older people among us that are at risk, and laughed with them when they realized, oh, that's us. Such good stuff, though, as a reminder that we can be careful and cautious and not fearful, right? It is so true, as a reminder of the peace that God gives us. And just as they said, He is the Prince of Peace, and He doesn't give the way that the world gives. He gives a peace that is entirely outside of this world, and we get to walk into that. So I want to start today talking about how Jesus is the light of the world. He is our now and forever and our final hope. And so let's start there. Let's start in John chapter 1 today, and I'm going to read just a chunk of chapter 1. In the beginning, the Word already existed. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. He existed in the beginning with God. God created everything through him, and nothing was created except through him. The Word gave life to everything that was created, and his life brought light to everyone. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness can never extinguish it. He came into the very world he created, but the world didn't recognize him. He came to his own people, and even they rejected him. But to all who believed him and accepted him, he gave the right to become children of God. They are reborn, not with a physical birth resulting from human passion or plan, but a birth that comes from God. So the Word became human and made his home among us. He was full of unfailing love and faithfulness, and we have seen his glory, the glory of the Father's one and only Son. In this, the beginning of this chapter, we begin to see who Jesus is, who he was then, who he is now, and who he always will be as the light, as the one who came. And even as it says in other parts of scripture, that he was the one who overcame darkness, that light overcomes darkness, that light will always overextend the darkness and exist beyond it. And the beauty of that is we see God's mercy and his grace and his love expressed. And as we begin to talk about the outward dimension of Jesus's life, and as we want to continue to imitate him, to become more like him and do the things that he did, we see that God is always the original initiator. The way that he reached out, that he bridged a gap between heaven and earth, between his kingdom and between this earth that he created, where we've had freedom to make choices and sin has infected and impacted the world in all kinds of negative ways. And we could never extend ourselves in a way to remedy and fix those things. But God began that work, and it's still happening in us today. And so as we think about what it looks like to imitate Jesus in the out aspect of his life, that he lived out toward the world, he was willing to go into places. He was available to people in ways that no religious leader ever was or ever could have been. And it brought him into direct conflict with the religious leaders of his day. And the beautiful part of this was you go back into the story in the beginning of Matthew about Jesus's birth and who he would be and how God spoke to his mother Mary and how she would be pregnant and how God began to speak to Joseph in a dream, telling him what his name would be. And then this introduction in what we look at as the New Testament of who Jesus would be called. And it says that Jesus would be called, that people would call him Emmanuel, God with us. It is probably my favorite name and reference to Jesus because it reminds me that God is not some distant, faraway being or character. He came and was with us and is still with us today. That we've never been abandoned by him, that he's never left us. In fact, when Jesus was speaking to his followers about returning to his kingdom in heaven, he said, I will not leave you and abandon you. I will send you, the Father will send you a helper who will be present with you. I'm not gonna leave you as orphans and abandon you. And we are still living today in the presence and with the presence and empowered by his Holy Spirit in us. What an incredible, this is unlike any other religion or belief in the world. It is one of the distinguishing factors of Christianity, the truth that God is a loving God who came to his people to reveal his love. That's there's no greater show of the out aspect of his love, that he reached out, but he didn't reach out from a distance. He came physically and lived a life, a human life in a human body. He's the living expression of this. It's who he is and it's what he did. He came to us. Not only that, but after Jesus was raised from the dead, he said to his disciples in John 20:21, he said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." He had been modeling and showing and sharing them this with them, this rhythm of life and doing life together, in how to worship and be intimate in prayer with the Father, and how to get away and establish a rhythm of aligning our hearts and our identities with him so that we could live in the world in a way that was captivating, that reveals the Father's very heart because of our presence here and his work in us. And revealing the Father's love and inaugurating the coming of his kingdom and his righteousness in the world. And the interesting thing about this is that this out aspect of our faith is probably one of the more challenging things, right? Oftentimes we don't feel adequate or we feel ill-equipped to begin to share our faith. Sometimes we think that the outward aspect of our faith, when we could call it evangelism, has to be orchestrated and planned, that we have to have events and outreaches and we have to have large gatherings where someone comes and speaks a gospel message and people respond. And all those things are good. They're not bad. Hear me right. But the fact of the matter is, God has placed each and every one of us in a family. He's placed each and every one of us in a neighborhood, in a workplace, in all these different spaces where he's given us influence and relationship, where we are to live outwardly toward people in those contexts in a way that reveals God's love and his goodness and his work in our lives, and that flows through us. That the aroma of that, that the nature of that is interesting, it's intriguing, and it gives room and space for people to ask questions and for us to be in relationship, right? It's a beautiful thing. We don't have to invite someone to a church function, while that's okay to do. We don't have to invite them to a group or a class. We can merely invite them into our lives. Or sometimes we're invited into others' lives, where there's a level of receptivity. And I wanna press into this a little bit. And one of the best opportunities to look at this is different times where Jesus sent his followers out in twos to kind of prepare the way for him. So let's look at Luke chapter 10. And this is gonna be something we'll unpack and look at and explore for the next few weeks. And this is the perfect time to do it, because this is the season where we remember that Jesus came and he chose us. So Luke chapter 10, verse 1, talking about how Jesus sent out the 72 in pairs, and he sent them out ahead of him into the towns and places that he planned to visit. And these were his instructions. "The harvest is great, but the workers are few. So pray to the Lord who's in charge of the harvest. Ask him to send more workers into his fields. Now go and remember that I'm sending you out as lambs among wolves. Don't take any money with you, a traveler's bag or an extra pair of sandals, and don't stop to greet anyone on the road." Now, here's a key. He said, "Whenever you enter someone's home, first say, 'May God's peace be on this house.' If those who live there are peaceful, the blessing will stand. If they are not, the blessing will return to you." Jesus revealed in this something that many of you have heard, this terminology, persons of peace. He began to say, where there's openness and receptivity, my peace will rest in that place, that there is an openness. In other words, people who are going to be receptive to you, some people, and other people will not be receptive to you, right? It's a very hard thing for each of us to learn. For me, I like to be liked. I don't know about you, but I've come to realize that not everyone likes me. Not everyone likes you, right? But God somehow creates opportunities for connection and relationships. And each of us are uniquely equipped to connect and relate with different kinds of people based on life experiences or any of those different kinds of things. And what he's telling them is, focus on the people who are receptive. Don't spend your time convincing people as to why they should be receptive to you. Spend your time investing and building relationship with those that you can. Focus on those who seek you out, right? Lots of people came to Jesus and he gave his time and attention and was available to them. Does that mean that we ignore everybody else? No, definitely not. But Jesus was very intentional never to force himself into a situation or a person's life. He told his disciples to be on the lookout for persons of peace. And a person of peace is simply someone who is open and maybe ready to hear the message of the gospel. There is a level of receptivity to whatever God might give you in the moment to share with somebody else. And a great example of this story is the rich young ruler. You can read about this story in Mark chapter 10, right? He came to Jesus asking him what he needed to do in order to receive eternal life. And Jesus kind of stated and shared the commandments with him. And he said, oh, I've been living those out and obeying them since I was very young. And then Jesus drops this bomb on him. And he says to the young ruler who was wealthy to sell everything that he owned, give it to the poor. And then he said, follow me. And the young ruler went away sad and dismayed because he had great wealth. He was unwilling to part with that wealth, that comfort, and that lifestyle in order to follow Jesus. And I've often wondered, and maybe you have too, why didn't Jesus give this young ruler more room? Why didn't he invite him to follow and allow him to, maybe soften it a little bit, you know, to come and see. And yet Jesus allows him to walk away. He didn't chase after him. He didn't try to convince him of anything. And I love what Michael Simpson notes in his book, Permission Evangelism. He says this, Christ didn't run after the rich young ruler because he knew the young man's heart wasn't ready. Jesus knew and let him walk. And Jesus never ran after anyone. Instead, he made himself available to those willing to wholeheartedly seek the way to God, the trust about God, and the life found in God. In this Advent season, and in every season, actually, we are to be on the lookout for the persons of peace. Looking out and expecting that our paths are going to cross with people who are open and receptive. Some of us live right next door to them. Some of us work in the cubicle next door. Some of you work in retail spaces or other kinds of places or own businesses where persons of peace will be coming and going constantly. And it's a matter of whether or not we can discern and see that's what's happening. And if we are hearing and sensing and seeing that that's happening, how are we living in a way where we are seeking God and asking him to guide and direct us to speak into people's lives, to be open and to be living in response, waiting and expecting that those questions will come. So we're gonna spend the next few weeks exploring the out aspect of Jesus's life and ministry and rhythms. And I want to encourage you with a few things. I want to challenge you to reflect on a few things. And I want to challenge you, as I'm going to begin to practice as well, just what if we began each day simply saying something to the effect of, Lord, bring a person of peace across my path today and give me grace to speak whatever you are prompting me to them. That we had an expectation that that's going to happen on a daily basis. What would that look like? So here's a few questions to begin to reflect on these next few weeks. Do you make time for relationships with non-Christians? Some of us live lives where we are so focused on how we connect and live and engage with each other that we don't make room in our lives for people who don't know and follow Jesus. Do you have a heart for people who don't know Jesus? Or is it too frustrating, challenging, or whatever to even try to engage with them, right? Here's another good one. Do you recognize persons of peace when you meet them? Let's begin to ask God to give us eyes to see those people, to be more aware. And are you willing to take risks to get out of your comfort zone, right? This is a good one. As we talked in previous weeks, this speaks to one of those areas of measures of our growth. Are we willing to cross borders for people to get out of our comfort zone? Because that is exactly what Jesus did. This is a season to remember that he stepped down off his throne, out of his kingdom, and into this dark and broken world. And he did that for us. And it didn't stop with him, and it continues through you and me. So I'd encourage you to invite others into this space, either in your discovery community or others that you're walking out your faith with, to begin to pray with you about persons of peace coming across your life. And I'd encourage you, when you have those moments and encounters, share that with the person you're praying with or with other people, and begin to just ask God to give you wisdom, discernment as to how to lean in with them and for those opportunities. So Holy Spirit, we thank you that you're speaking. We thank you that this is a season in particular where there is a different and more significant level of hope and openness. Lord, and as things, as the pandemic continues to unfold and we enter into a challenging season, we thank you, Jesus, that we would truly learn to rest and to receive your peace, and that it is not for us to keep to ourselves, it is to share with other people. So may your peace rest on each of us and our homes and families right now, and may your peace through us rest on those that you are drawing near to yourself. We thank you that you're inviting us into that with you. We love you, Lord. We trust you. And we're so thankful for you and for one another. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We're going to hear some more stories of hope as we get toward Christmas and begin sharing what you can expect for the rest of this month for services, times, opportunities to engage together. And so we'll see you next time, church.
We hope you enjoyed that message. Make sure to stay tuned for exciting information coming up on Christmas Eve. We cannot wait. We'll see you next time.